Graham Coxon. Good morning, Graham.
Good morning, Stuart.
How are you?
Oh, yeah, pretty good, thank you. Quite sprightly for 9 a.m.
Would you normally be up this early?
Yeah.
Would you be good?
yeah. I do wake up quite comfortably early normally.
Yeah, good to know. And so, the Superstate project. I mean, I'm looking down here at Superstate. Said the Independent is his solo masterpiece. High praise indeed.
Yeah, well, that's what it was always meant to be when I was working on it. And hopefully it might be something like that.
Great.
I've certainly spent a lot of time and thought and effort over it. So I don't know whether it is. Did they say masterpiece?
They did say masterpiece.
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, that would be nice.
Yeah.
Pretty pleased with how it turned out.
So tell us, we're going to play Uncle Sam in a moment from it, but tell us the idea. It's a unique experience, a graphic novel with an accompanying soundtrack. Tell us, was the idea originally yours?
The idea was originally mine, and I started writing songs a theme was sort of appearing, and it came out of a sort of something that I started to do with my own voice, where I pretended to be somebody else, enable me to sing different melodies and sing different words. And I was also experimenting with a lot more home recording technology. So I had a lot more sort of paintbrushes, if you like, to my sonic thingamajig. So and using loops and things like that, and using guitar and writing melodies around, you know, from using a bass and using keyboards and things like that rather instead, and going rhythmically different. And it all started sounding a little bit, I just started writing about things that I thought were frightening, but were vague enough for me to bend into some sort of narrative, vague enough to for people to attach their own thoughts and feelings onto the music, which I suppose I sort of learned by doing the soundtracks, where you can't be too strong with your narrative within a song, because it's got to fit what's going on visually and in a story and emotionally. To action. So, but I just started coming up with the story as I went along, and they were sort of kitchen sink dramas, and I almost thought that I was making a sort of a musical Netflix series, and a story started to come out of that, really.
Right. Well, maybe we'll talk a bit more after the news about exactly what that narrative entails and what the sort of subject matter of it is. But let's hear a track from it now. Can we just hear this completely out of context, or do you want to sit Uncle Sam in a sort of context, Graham?
No, you can. It's you know, the usual sort of thing about paranoia, about an unmasked narcissistic society, people are running our lives.
Okay, yeah. Good. Oh, yeah. All that usual good stuff. This is from Superstate. This is Graham and Uncle Sam. Past everything, in this part of the show, we ask our special guest for the morning about their musical enthusiasms, first, last and everything, and also what they're up to now. And this morning, as you'll have heard just before the news, I'm delighted that it's Graham Coxon. I think if that Uncle Sam track I played before the news is the first thing that people have heard of the Superstate project, I mean, it is brilliant. It's also, I think, people will be thinking, wow, because we associate Graham with very guitar-based music. Often your solo albums have been quite folky in this is a real sonic kind of departure, isn't it?
Yeah, obviously there are guitars there, but I was entertaining my preoccupations with other areas of music, really.
Yeah.
I've always been a sort of a fan of disco and funky things, but also of prog rock. And in a lot of ways, I was trying to marry something like Sly and the Family Stone with King Crimson.
Wow.
Or something like that.
That sounds like my kind of music.
Yeah. But I mean, it's kind of varied. That one goes to a sort of almost Cuban-y kind of feel.
Yeah.
When I do my squawky sax solo at the end. And there's a sort of a brass section. But there are still bits where I sort of get going with, yeah. with some big, messy, broad strokes on the guitar.
We'll talk about what some of the ideas expressed in it are in a moment. Let's do some of your first, last and everything stuff, though. The first track you ever... is it the first track you ever bought with Roxanne by the Police?
I think it was probably the first single I bought, although that's... there might have been another one when I was slightly younger, but we don't have to talk about that
one. Okay. Okay. I mean, the thing about the Police, perhaps these days not regarded as the coolest of bands, but they could all play, couldn't they?
No, they're not. They weren't particularly cool. But then I was 9, I think, when I first heard this. And it wasn't on the radio, I don't think, very much at all. Probably because of the subject matter, which yeah. didn't bother me when I was 9. And it still doesn't bother me. But no, I mean, I don't know whether they were cool in 1978 or they were very uncool then, or they became uncool
very
rapidly. I'm not sure. What do you reckon?
I don't know. I think it might be that maybe some of Sting's activities and pronouncements later on made them a bit sort of a bit uncool. But I think some of the early Police records are absolutely brilliant. Let's hear a bit of Roxanne, Graham's first purchase at the age of 9. Purchase of Graham Coxon, age 9, Roxanne by the Police. The Superstate, this project, Graham, let me spell out what it is. You have written 15 original songs, and then there are 15 stories featuring 15 artists. So it's a hell of a... it must have all done during lockdown, this, was it, Graham?
Well, not really. I wrote the first song... called We Remain. It's on the album. Yeah. I wrote that the day David Bowie died. So it's quite a long time ago. Okay. I mean, the music was finished in 2018-19. So that's been around for a little while. And I was wondering just how to best visually represent it. And I was sort of thinking about the story an awful lot, and the sort of what was happening in each of the different songs, and I just feel that I had to really expand on it, and it would bug me forever if I didn't get a proper sort of story together. And so a comic book seemed like the only way to sort of get across the visuals in the most expansive,
yeah,
beautiful or disturbing way. Without, spending billions of pounds on trying to make a film or something like that.
Yeah, and the album and cover artwork is done by you, but there's 15 other artists. Did you choose the artist yourself, or did you have some suggested to you?
I worked with Z2 Comics, and they just suggested people, and I just looked through tons and tons and tons of graphic artists or comic artists, and we just chose one for each song,
or
each scenario.
Okay, well, we'll come back to maybe saying a little bit what some of those stories entail in a moment, and I'll tell people about the availability of how they can get hold of Superstate. So Steely Dan, are these a recent enthusiasm of yours, Graham?
By the way, what attracted me to Roxanne is I thought it sounded like the Beatles when I was 9. I think the production is amazing, stripped down, and personality in each of their tiny little parts is so strong. I could not resist that song when I was a kid.
There's hardly anything going on in it, isn't there? But yeah, everything that's going on is brilliant, yeah.
But I can listen to the snare drum all day. But that's because now I'm into sort of production. What's weird about Steely Dan? Yeah, I kind of resisted or didn't quite understand it for ages, and then I became determined to get into it. So I bought a best of Steely Dan, and I would listen to it on long journeys. And after the third listen of this album, I was absolutely like, "Oh my god, this is like, I am now old enough to be that sad," and I absolutely think this is some of the best music ever created. And
wow!
And finally, when I moved to LA. I moved there for a little bit, and I had to go to the NAMM, the NAMM, the huge music kind of production,
right?
Like music messy thing.
Yeah.
Over in Los Angeles, near Disneyland. And I got there, and I think the following day I hired a car and drove right the way across Los Angeles. I'd only just landed. and I sort of drove right the way across there to Los Angeles, and I listened to Steely Dan the whole way on those massive, huge
roads. Wow.
And it sort of made an enormous amount of sense suddenly, because the M2 isn't quite the place to listen to Steely Dan, because I was going to Margate, Ramsgate quite a lot for work and bits and bobs like that. But when I got on those big roads,
yeah,
which are in themselves a sort of, you know, a dice with death.
Yeah.
It all sort of clicked into place, and the sort of snarling wit, etc.
Yes. Yeah.
I just loved it. You know, I suddenly just absolutely loved it.
Let's hear a bit of Black Cow and Transport Graham back to the freeways of LA. Like a gangster. Our regular listeners, as we've got a little bit of a short show, what we're doing is taking little extracts from the first and last tracks, but we're going to play our guest's everything track in its entirety, which is coming up in a little while. Graham Coxon's my guest this morning. The Superstate idea is that we're looking at a world in which, well, to call it dystopian, I guess, would be an understatement, wouldn't it, Graham?
I suppose it's dystopian, and I know dystopia is kind of... I don't really like dystopic things. I find it extremely anxiety-inducing.
Right.
And it became a kind of a big thing, particularly when my eldest was a teenager.
Right.
And you know, and I sort of don't like this view that it seems to be setting a precedent for real events and a sort of an acquiescent sort of mindset.
Really, yeah, I get that. People. Yeah.
This is what's coming. We better get on with it. You know what I mean? And yeah, it is compelling and a sort of seductive way, I suppose, to divide people in a society with sort of evil overlords that are having huge amounts of fun, and common people who are struggling every day to exist and finding some ways out,
yeah,
of their experiences. But I wanted to put something supernatural in there, and some place of hope and mess around with the idea of what heaven is and what visitations and there's sort of angelic visitations. Which are not sort of, you know, nativity story sort of visitations, more like Old Testament, pretty scary at times visitations and confusing and terrifying at the same time. But I also wanted it to be across the board, really, emotionally. There are songs that are a little bit about being a parent. There are songs that were written as encouragement to young people, particularly young women, and to believe in themselves and to believe in their own individuality and to believe in their own future and to do what sets their heart alight and follow that route. So in amongst the sort of broken robot girlfriends and the terror sort of terrorist organisations and religious maniacs, there is sort of hope.
There is some hope there, yeah. It's fantastic. Well, I should tell people that you can experience Superstate in many different ways. It's a digital standalone release, the music, but also with vinyl. A deluxe bundle includes the soundtrack, the hardback of the book. So really, check out Superstate. If you look out for Superstate, Graham Coxon, and you'll be able to see all the manner of ways in which you can experience it in the full glory of the 15 stories and the artwork and the music or whatever way you want to do it. And it's tremendous. And as you'll know if you heard that Uncle Sam track. It is tremendous stuff. So before I let you go, Graham, you're everything. We're going to talk about Talk Talk. What does Talk Talk mean to you?
Oh, they just, I don't know. I got into Talk Talk quite late. I mean, I don't know, Spirit of Eden. I had that around for ages. You know, it's 1988 it was released now, so it's a long time. But during the 90s, it was given to me, I think, by EMI, and I'd give it a little listen. And it was another thing where I listened to it, and it just seemed to fit with my mindset. And there's something about Talk Talk when they got looser, they got more improvisational. Is that the right word?
Yeah, yeah.
And the vagueness and the lyrics, again, you can sort of put all sorts of your own associations onto it. But the sort of clustering, rather like the sort of brass arrangements on Black Cow, this kind of clustering of notes and things that I really find beautiful. And that and this year as well, I've had a lot of anxiety and sort of stress. Also some really great things going on as well, but I find just talk are brilliant. A bit like, you know, Debussy. I stick it on when I'm feeling like I'm having a bit of anxiety or stroke too much coffee, and it calms me down, you know. And this year I got more and more into laughingstock as well, and I enjoy sound of it. I enjoy the imperfection of it. I enjoy the fact that you can hear things off mic. You know, I like getting inside it and having a good look around. It's good music for that.
Graham's everything from Spirit of Eden we're going to play, Inheritance by Toto. It's always lovely to talk to you, Graham.
You too, Stu.
See you soon. Bye.
Say hi to Mark. Bye.